So I hand over the stage to you, sir, and I also thank you in advance for accepting our request and addressing our final year students. I'm sure that during this pandemic time, the valuable inputs that you provide them will be really useful to them, especially since it's final year students. Thank you, sir.
So thank you, Dr. Rajesh, for allowing us to present to your final year student. So student, hi, this is Abhishek Desai from RISA School of Built Environment, and Dr. Pradeep HR Pradeep sir is there, who is going to take you through the career opportunities in built environment industry post COVID-19. So he'll mainly focus on the what all opportunities are available in future. So that will be very helpful for you. Apart from that, a participation certificate will be given to all the students who are going to attend this webinar. So do attend this webinar completely. Approximately 40 to 45 minutes the presentation is going to last, and I'll just share a link in your chat box. So just click on that link and fill up that form so that you will get your e-participation certificate as well. I'll also share a sample copy so that you will understand how exactly it looks like. So this is a sample certificate which you are going to get after attending this webinar. If you have any concern or query, you can just type in the comment section. So we'll be happy to answer them at the end of the presentation. At the same time, you can also, if you have any other queries, you can also chat, put it in the chat box, or you can discuss in the last, towards the end of the session. So I think Pradeep sir, we can start the presentation. So Dr. Pradeep, HR Pradeep sir is there. We'll be taking you through the career opportunities in built environment. Thank you, everyone. So we can start the presentation. I request Pradeep sir to take over the stage and share his PPTs.
Yeah, good afternoon all. Sorry, there was some technical issue. I was not able to unmute myself. Okay, I'll start the sharing of the screen.
Yes, sir.
You're able to see the screen?
Yes, sir, we are able to see it.
Yes, sir.
Okay, that's great. This is good afternoon, everyone, students. It's nice to be with you all through online portal. Yep. Let's start with the career opportunities and rapidly changing built environment sector post COVID-19. Why we are saying rapidly changing? Because we all know how things are changing because of the pandemic, which has hit for the past 1 year almost, right? Now, let's see, before we get into that, let's understand what do we understand by built environment, right? So what do you understand by built environment? The place we live, the place we work in, the place which we travel to, right? The places we shop at, or the places we go for entertainment, right? So all these things coming under built environment, right? So we can divide the entire thing into two parts. One is the built environment and another is the environment. So when we say built environment, again, so that can be considered or that can be divided into three headings, three major components of in under construction, say like construction, real estate, and infrastructure. When you talk about real estate, anything which is related to land or buildings, this comes under real estate. How is this? Whether it vacant land or whether you are planning to develop that particular land into a commercial project, residential project, or a public project, right? So that all comes under real estate. When you talk about buildings, it can be a residential building, it can be office building, it can be commercial buildings, malls, all this thing comes under buildings of real estate. So this real estate includes a lot of other opportunities like it, land acquisition, planning and building approval, feasibility study, financial aspects of the project, project consulting, sales and marketing, leasing, facility management. These are the things which comes in as a whole in the real estate domain. When we talk about infrastructure is, we all know, without infrastructure, we cannot survive, right? We need energy, we need power, we need telephone, mobiles, right? We need TV. We need transportation from one place to another. The roads, railways, airports, right? All those things comes under this. Then your urban and rural infrastructure. So improving the all your infrastructures, whether it is electrical, water supply, drainage system, right? All those things comes under this particular infrastructure concept. So in under infrastructure, again, you can say like it can be a concept design, it can be detailed design, project finance, construction, rehabilitation. Rehabilitation means the rehabilitation of any structures, bridge structures, rehabilitation, or right, any operation and maintenance of these services. All these things comes under infrastructure heading. So when we talk about construction, construction is there in both real estate as well as infrastructure, right? So we need to develop any project, we need to construct that. So that is why construction is very important aspect. Here in construction, it includes design, technical feasibility study, planning, procurement, production, execution of the project, operation and maintenance, restorations, retrofittings, and recycling and redevelopment. So all these things comes under construction. Construction can be part, again, it can be real estate construction, it can be infrastructure construction. So all as a whole, real estate, infrastructure, and construction all together comes under built environment, right? So this is how the built environment can be divided. And this is where you can think of your opportunities here. So one of the survey which says, according to World Bank, more than 70% of the global wealth is related to land, property, and construction. So now you can imagine how important this built environment sector is required for the global economy, right? Now, when we talk about the built environment carriers, see it, when we see a project construction project, you must have studied this in your course, right? Construction project starts with project initiation, then it comes project planning, then it's your project execution, then monitoring and control, and then finally closure of project. So this is what is a project life cycle looks like. Yes or no, right? In the project initiation, it is basically you, the client comes to a consultant and say he talks about what is required in the project, what is the scope of the project, what is the definition of the project, all those things comes in. When we talk about project planning, you need to plan for your time, manpower, material, machineries, and the finance or the money, which how you are going to do the project or how you are going to execute the project. Now, the next step comes in project execution. Here, you whatever you have designed in the planning stage, you're going to make it a reality, right? So then the project monitoring and control. What is monitored in project monitoring and control? Basically, the cost, time, and quality is monitored and controlled in this particular process. Then project closure is basically close all your issues related to any snags, de-snags, all those things, complete it and hand over to the end user. So that is the project closure. So this is the project life cycle of a construction project. But when we talk about a life cycle in a built environment sector, so we'll say it as built environment project life cycle. So here, the project life cycle start with feasibility study, right? So feasibility study is one. Then you need to have land acquisition. You need to have design and development. You need to, in between feasibility and land acquisition, we also have to have some due diligence, valuation, consulting research. These are the things which are required before we can start our project. So once we have this, we also need to understand what is the working capital requirement, how is the project finance going to happen. All those things needs to be discussed and agreed upon between the different stakeholders. Now once we have the design development, then we go into construction. When we go into construction, we also look at construction funding. Then at the end of the project or the mid of the project, we start taking out the funds for different aspects or what the return on investment is started to come in. Now, in between, we also start marketing. So you would have seen many developers who start their project, and they also at the parallelly, they start the marketing and sales, right? Apartments. When you initially buy any apartment, or when you go to see any apartment, it's not ready. They only make up a mock-up on the site, and they say, this is how the end product will look like, right? And then based on that, you will purchase it. Yes or no? So they are actually starting the marketing also, marketing and sales. So here, during the marketing and sales, why it has to be done? To make sure there is no problem for a continuous cost, cash flow in the project. That is for the construction activities. So when we are talking about construction activities, marketing and sales, we need to know what is the value of that project, right? At what cost it can be sold, whether it is really worth that particular cost. So we need to have a proper valuation of the project or the valuation of the property. So that's where valuation comes into picture in this section. Then you see there is operation and maintenance. Once we have the project handed over to the client or the end users, it is not the end of the project, right? We need to operate and we need to maintain those things, right? So whether it is commercial project, whether it's a residential project, right? Any of them, it needs operation and maintenance. Why? Because there are a lot of public spaces, right? So the public spaces has to be managed by a particular team, or developers has to manage those public or the common areas and the common facilities which are available in the project. So that's why operation and maintenance is also very important here. So not everyone in the when they're buying a property are buying for themselves. They may be buying for their own investment purpose. They want to lease or rent in the future. So that's how the leasing and rental team will come into picture here. And then that is under asset management. So asset management is whatever asset you have, whether it is a house, whether it is a shop, whether it is an office space. So that needs to be rented or leased to somebody. So how, who will do this? So that is why asset management team comes into picture here. So then at the same time, once the operation and maintenance start, the facility management teams also get into this. So other than that, the investment sales. So whoever has invested at the initial time of the project, he may wants to sell it off. So where, how he will sell it? So that's basically investment sales comes into picture. So this is the overall life cycle of a project with respect to built environment. So this can be easily divided into two aspects. One is real estate and urban infrastructure, and construction project management. So these are the two headings which the entire life cycle of built environment can be divided into. Now let's see where you can get fit into different sectors. So under built environment sector, first is the developer. Who is the developer? Whoever has the property and who wants to develop that into different aspects, whether it is residential or commercial. So the he is the developer. So once a developer starts planning for the execution of the project, the PMC, the project management consultant, comes into picture. So once project management consultant, then your consultant like architectural consultant, structural consultant, MEP consultants, right? Cost consultant, valuation consultant. So all these things comes into picture for detailed design and planning of the entire project. So once we have the plan, we need to value and we need to have a surveyors for that, quantity surveyors, right? So that is another sector where we can look at a career in built environment. So once we have the entire planning is ready, entire costing is done, contract is signed between developer and contractor, then the contractor starts executing the project. Under this execution, there is a huge number of engineers and managers to the execute that project. So this is another opportunities for in the built environment sector. Then of course, the government agencies. How does the government agencies, all your public works agencies, your town planning agencies, right? All those things require engineers to come in from built environment sector. So this is how the broad areas in which you can look at your careers in built environment. Let's see, go in detail, like what are the scope or what are the positions we can look at as a built environment career. So it can be into design and development, project management, contracts management, construction management, BIM, that is building information modeling consultant, infrastructure management, cost management, quantity surveying, quality assurance and quality control, HSE management, this is health, safety and environment management, procurement management. So these are the things which you look at as the construction management sector. Now, if you look at the real estate and urban infrastructure management, it can be interior management, facility management, green building management, property management, sales and marketing, banking sector, insurance companies, non-banking financial companies, international property consultants, town planning and development, policy development, implementation and management. So the last two is basically your government agencies and banking sector, insurance companies, non-banking financial companies, then international property consultants. These are basically is your sales and marketing background or basic home insurance, home loans. All these things require an engineering graduate to evaluate that particular property and say whether this property worth that or not. So that's why banking sector, insurance companies also require built environment professionals with financial background, right? Sales and marketing also require executives from engineering graduates are required. So these are the different headings under which you can look at your making up your career in the future. Now, we know this, so many opportunities are there, but are we really ready to take up these roles? That is the biggest question we need to ask ourselves. Now, we have noticed there is a major skill gap in India. So we need about 5.2 million professionals by 2022. And every year about 1.5 million engineers graduates, but out of which 80% are not found employables by companies. This is not, I'm not saying this, this is from the report, right? So why this is happening? 80% of the people, why they're not employable? Because they don't have the required skills for the new age jobs, right? Only about 2% of engineers have the skill needed to work in new age jobs. So this is a source from India Today. I am not saying it without the data, right? So why this is happening? There's so many projects which have been constructed in and around your college itself, right? You can see if you go out in your surrounding in your college area, there's huge development which are happening. But if you go and approach them, will you be able to crack a job there? No, because you don't. The engineering curriculum doesn't give required skills for the new age job. How can you update yourself? You need to go and do some external courses, right? And then you need to update yourself. Now, if you have seen latest educational reformation, which has been in discussion, they're saying there will be 6 months minimum internship on job site for all engineers. So once that comes in, there will be some difference. This more number of engineer graduates will be employable. So because of this particular reason or because of this particular survey, the government has understood like 80% of Indian engineers are not employable because they don't have the required skills. So that is why all these reformations are getting into action. Now let's see what are the kind of skills we require, right? I'll just skip this. This is, see, the skills required for future jobs, like we need lean and green construction technologies, prefabricated buildings, right? You can see a lot of prefabrication, prefabricated building coming up around Bangalore itself. Many companies are getting into this, field now. Then advanced project management skills. What are these advanced project management skills? You need to know how you can manage the project, how you can bring back, bring maximum profit to the organization. So these are the things which you require in this. Building information modeling. How many of you are exposed to building information modeling, if I ask you? I doubt even 10% of the graduate engineers know about building information modeling because it is not taught in engineering level. Now, scheduling, project scheduling using Primavera, MS Project, Tylos. See, these are the softwares which can give better perspective for managing the project. Then cost estimate and cost control through softwares like Costex, Candy. So these are the softwares which are available for cost management. Then you have facility management, right? Then project management and resource estimation skills. So unless you are exposed to the site, unless you are exposed to project environment, we'll not be able to manage this. We'll not be able to estimate the resources, right? Communication and team building, which is one of the very important aspects in the present scenario. If you cannot communicate and if you cannot be a team player, it becomes very difficult to have a good project management team. And then you should be able to manage multiple contractors and resolve conflicts. Unless you know how to manage the different contractors at the same time and how you can resolve conflicts between these contractors, it becomes very difficult. Now, we know in any construction project, we need a civil engineer, we need a mechanical engineer, we need electrical engineer, right? We need a water supply engineer. So we need to have these different people and we should be able to manage all the resources and any conflict coming between them should be resolved effectively. So that's why this is very important. Then controlling time overrun and cost overrun. We have seen most of the projects in India are either it is time overrun is done or it is cost overrun has happened. Why? Because they are not following the proper project tools and they are not controlling the project in the right manner. So that is why this is happening. Then of course, energy conservation and sustainability. We all talk about sustainability, green building, right? But how many of the engineers knows how we can be sustainable, how we can conserve the energy, how we can conserve water, right? How we can conserve the overall earth requirement. Nobody knows about it. Why? Because it is not thought in our career or not thought in our engineering courses. Then contracts and risk management. So whenever we are having a contract, there is always a risk involved in every project. So unless you are able to foresee these risks and try to plan for any management requirement and how to mitigate those risks at the given time, it becomes very difficult for project manager. So these are the different skills you will require for future job. Now, coming to one of them is sustainability, as we have discussed. And I will say, what is sustainable development? So when we say sustainability, it is defined as meeting the needs of present without compromising the ability of future generation to meet their own needs. So this definition was coined by Brundtland Commission in 1987, which was published in Our Common Future, right? So this was done by World Commission on Environment and Development. This was accepted and endorsed by Rio Earth Summit in 1992. So we all know this was the first major international summit which happened for making sustainable development, right? Now, after this, there were many events or lot many conferences have been done, and right now what we look at is SDGs, that is Sustainable Development Goals. That is what we are working on. Wherever you see, we talk about SDGs. So there are different SDGs which are formulated, and the entire world is working towards those SDGs. Now, out of the different sustainability aspects which we need to consider, these are the some of the best practices, or a best practice framework we say needs to be adopted. So first is energy efficiency and conservation, how we can manage or how we can reduce the overall energy utilized in our day-to-day activities. We all see energy efficient equipments, right? Whatever equipment we use, fridge, washing machine, TV. So we all see number of stars. So higher the star, is the better is the efficiency of that equipment, right? So that is how we can reduce the consumption of the energy. Then water and wastewater system. So how can we reduce water? How can we reuse the wastewater? How best it can be reused? So these things comes under this particular aspects. Now, then the green building, there are many green building certification agencies like IGBC, Griha, right, BRIM. So these are all Indian certification bodies. Then we have international certification bodies like USGBC LEED certification, which is one of the most common across the globe right now. So on what basis they do a certification? They basically look at how you are using your different sustainability aspects in your project, whether you have used water efficiency, you have used energy efficiency, have you used recycled material, right? How you are using, are you using any renewable sources for the energy requirement? So all these things comes under this green building concept. Then waste reduction and recycling. So we all know, or we should understand, construction industry gives out the maximum number of maximum amount of waste to the environment in different sources. So we need to reduce the waste, and we need to maximize the recycling and reusing of this waste material. So that is how we can reduce this. So lean practices is one of the best way to reduce waste, right? Then the next one is climate friendly purchasing. We all purchase the goods and equipments, or goods and technology, mobile phones, TVs, other aspects, just because somebody else is having. So we don't look at whether do we really need it or not. Especially when somebody is buying a first two-wheeler or upgrading it to in a four-wheeler. So he or she should understand whether he really requires it. Do not compare with others because he's having, I want to have it. So this kind of comparison and purchasing should be avoided. That is when we can become climate friendly purchasing. Why? Because any material which we are buying, it is producing some impact on the environment. So that's why we call this as a climate friendly purchasing. Then, of course, renewable energy and low carbon fuels, which we need to get into. So renewable energies like wind energy, tidal energy, solar energy, we need to move towards this instead of using coal or atomic energy for producing the electrical energy. So if we are able to move 100% to renewable energy, that is when we can reduce the maximum impact on environment. Then efficient transportation. So we all know how problematic is Bangalore transport. If you want to travel from one place to other in Bangalore, it is quite difficult. We all know that, right? So why we say efficient transportation? We should have maximum, the best public transport. Then we automatically, the congestions and number of vehicles moving on the road will reduce. So that's why we have to have efficient transportation system. Then coming to land use and community design. So we all know this, I will combine eighth and ninth together because it is common kind of thing. The open space and offsetting carbon emission. So this both, when we are planning any new development, we need to make sure we have a proper designated areas for different purpose of the different purpose of land use. So there is a dedicated residential plot, there are dedicated office plots, and there are dedicated industrial space when we are planning a town. So this is basically when we are looking at a larger picture, town planning and development. So we need to have sufficient open spaces so that you have more greeneries, so which can offset your carbon emissions from different sources. So you can always have a comparison. If you are anywhere outside where there is more construction is there, more buildings are there, and if you move from there to a garden area, automatically or immediately you will feel a difference of at least 2 to 3 degree temperature. Why? Because the green cover which is there, it reduces the temperature because it takes out carbon dioxide from the environment. So this is how we can reduce carbon emission, or we can offset the carbon emission having more green space around our project. Then of course every individual has to be aware and has to contribute to sustainability. That's why community and individual action is also becomes very important. As an individual, as a community, how you are giving, or how you are able to sustain, or how you are able to reduce the waste or reduce the energy utilization, how you can improve the open spaces, right? So that is how this community action and individual action comes into picture. Now this is all about sustainability. Let's move to the next important aspect, which is actually fastly changing in the construction industry or a built environment industry, is unmanned aerial vehicles. So this is getting into thing. You all know surveying land, how difficult or how time consuming it can be, right? You must have studied in your engineering using a dumpy level, theodolite, then maybe a advanced dumpy level or an advanced Sokisha leveling equipment. Then you must have also studied about total stations, right? So with all these things, still it requires a huge amount of time and manpower to do a surveying of a given land. Now this can be done in few minutes using this UAVs. So this basically is replacing the traditional land surveillance methods, right? So initially we used to say bird's eye view, now it is getting into drones eye view. So this is basically UAVs are drones. You must have seen in many marriage functions, the drones are running with having a camera connected to it, and they're able to take photos and videos from different levels and different directions using these drones. So similarly, these drones are able to capture the required land surveying points, and they are able to reproduce it very fast, complete topography of that particular area by using the software. So unless we know about these things, how drones can work, how it can be beneficial to us, we'll not be able to get good jobs in the future. Now, this drones basically eliminate maximum human error which can happen during the surveying. So the other important thing is improvements to infrastructure. These drones can actually provide some information, or it can be part of like supervision equipment to make sure there is no possible of there is no any problem during the project execution. Infrastructure project is like, if you are doing a highway project or a railway project, you need to understand a huge area. By monitoring that area will becomes very difficult. So if you have some few drones which can easily move around the entire portion, sitting in the office, one single person can monitor the entire project. So that is how the infrastructure needs to be. Infrastructure projects, drones are being used. Now, the next one is the prefabricated home. And automation of that prefabrication of construction is becoming the growing sector presently. So unless we know about prefabrication and how automation can help prefabrication, it becomes difficult. So here, housing development across the globe are preferring prefabrication or prefabricated homes in is the most convenient way of construction, because it can avoid maximum quality issues, and it can reduce the cost, and it can increase the productivity. Why? Because it is, everything is constructed or everything is fabricated under a typical industrial controlled environment, and only an assembly is done in site. Erection and assembly is done in site. So that can increase productivity. So in Japan, about 16% of the homes are built using prefabrication techniques, whereas in Sweden, almost it is 40% of the homes are built with prefabrication technique. So with looking at this, India is also moving towards it, and in the couple of years or in 5 to 10 years down the lane, we'll see only prefabricated constructions happening across the world. So it can basically reduce the manpower and increase the productivity of and automation in prefabricated construction. Then IoT in construction, this is IoT, Internet of Things. So this can help in monitoring the concrete curing, the concrete development of strength development, right? And it can easily help us in scheduling and cycling of formwork and optimization of labors during the construction process. So once we insert these, some of the sensors in the concrete during casting itself, it can give us the real-time development of strength. So this will help us better schedule and better profitability in the future projects. Now, for safety and security, we can also have this real-time job site mapping, which can reduce the risk in the project site. So that's how this IoT can help us in built environment sector. Now, coming to building information modeling, this is basically a process involving different functions are combined into one platform, whether it is design, whether it is costing, whether it is planning, all those things can be coming under one platform. BIM is not a software. BIM is only a platform where all these things can be combined. So it can give a good robotic, it can give rise to good robotic construction in the future. So it can use historical data and predict the future project, how we can improve the efficiency of the project. So when we talk about BIM, we should understand what is, at least for this level, at least in India, we have already started to use 5D BIM. So we global way, there's gone to 6D, 7D BIM, 8D BIM also, but we are still in 5D BIM. That also, very few companies and very few projects are following this BIM technology. So this is basically, it can integrate your design aspect, your scheduling aspect, and cost aspect of the project. So we say 3D, that is your design, that is geometry of the project, your structure, your everything comes into that, right? So that is it. You would have said as a 3D plan, right? So it gives you 3D view of the project. So that is 3D. And the fourth dimension, which are included in the BIM, is the project schedule and monitoring of the schedule. And then the fifth dimension of the BIM is budget, or the cost management, cost estimation, and cost control. So all those things comes in one package, that is 5D BIM. So unless we understand what is the, how we can use this BIM modeling in our managing the project, it becomes very difficult in the future. Now the other one, the next technology which we are getting into is 3D printing. We all know what 3D printing is, right? Anybody know about 3D printing and whether 3D printing is used in construction? Yes, it is used in construction, right? And we all know this 40% of the world's total waste is created by construction industry. Now, how we can reduce it? If we can reduce the waste generated on each site, and if we can make them use it or reuse it, those things. Now, basically, we as engineers or an architects, we are constrained because of geometric limitations of casting concrete into formwork. This 3D printing of building can get over this particular casting to into formworks. Now, how this is done? So this one of the major project which is completed, a two-story building completed in Dubai within 11 months using 3D printing technology. This is in Dubai. This is for a Dubai municipality project which is completed last year and which is having very limited workforce on site. So with hardly 4 to 5 people could have managed this project to complete in 11 months. So for a, if you imagine for a normal two-story building, how many laborers will be involved in completing that project? There are thousands of labor is required to complete a project. But here with the 3D printing, it can reduce the cost of construction, it can reduce the time of construction, it can reduce the overall manpower requirement for the construction. So this is basically using a robotic technology to complete a project. A robot is doing the entire construction. So this is another project which is in Austin, Texas. It completed the project in with very minimum people, that is crew of 5 members on an average, with a 1-ton Vulcan equipment tall, and it's a 28 feet tall wide project which was completed in less than 10 months, right? So this is how the construction is changing with respect to new technologies, and this is one of them is 3D printing. Now we will take it up into a different league. Now, should you study techno managerial course? Yes. Why? Because you need to understand, you need to improve your technical knowledge with respect to the different technologies which are required or the different skill set which are required to be in the market for the present and the future jobs. And you need to be you need to learn the managerial skills, like how to manage yourself, how to manage the people, how to manage the cost, how to manage different aspects of the project. So that's why you need a managerial skill. So that's the reason we talk about techno managerial course. Now, 4 reasons why it is time to choose specialized MBA course. We say be ready to meet the demand, widen your career opportunities, be a techno manager, and go global with internationally accredited courses. So we, as an RICS, we are organization which is established in 1868, and we have more than 1.5 lakh members across 146 countries. So this is the small background of RICS, and it is based in London. It is a full form is Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors, and it was it is governed by a royal charter, right? Now, what do we do in the built environment sector? Offer preeminent global professional qualifications like MRICS or FRICS. Embed technical practice standards in members. We have, as I said, 1.5 lakh members are there across the globe, and it's keep increasing every day. Provide professional education and training. Regulate the members. Policy advocacy to the government, and cutting edge research and market analysis. These are the different fields which RICS is supporting the built environment. Now, the entire India RICS SBE, that is School of Built Environment from RICS Amity University, is the only course or the only college which is accredited by RICS UK, and it is equivalent to many universities, many well-known universities across the globe. So for some of them, we have been just mentioned here, right? National University of Singapore, Northumbria University, UK, Nottingham University in UK, right? Salford University, UK, right? Then you have Hong Kong, you have different in Australia, US, and New York University in USA. So these are some of the, even the Cambridge University in UK, Oxford University in UK. So these are some of the universities under which or the course, the degree course which you get from this particular MBA degree is equivalent to taking a degree from any of these universities. And to add to this, the entire India RICS SBE MBA Construction Project Management is the only course which is accredited by Project Management Institute of USA for that project management professionals. Across India, this is the only course which is accredited. So you can go global because of having two international accreditation for a degree program at RICS SBE. So these are the different degree programs and diploma programs which are offered by RICS. We have MBA 2 years program, MBA CPM, Construction Project Management, MBA Real Estate and Urban Infrastructure, and MBA in Construction Economics and Quantity Surveying. And we also have a 3 years graduate degree program, that is BBA in Real Estate Urban Infrastructure. And we also have a postgraduate diploma in Facility Management. So these are the different courses which RICS offers. And these are some of the companies which takes our students for their placements. Many national and international companies come and take our students for their through campus interviews. And I will hand over the mic to Abhishek, please.
Thank you, Dr. Pradeep, for taking us through so informative presentation. So student, if you have any concern or query, you can just type it in the chat box. You can also visit our website ricssb.org for more details about the courses. And also mobile number is mentioned on the slide. So you can also contact me on this 4 times 9 7 4 6 3 1 9, or you can contact Ms. Rajlakshmi for any query about courses. If you have any query about courses, or if you have any query about the presentation today, you can just type in the chat box, or you can just unmute yourself and let us know your query so we can answer it right away.